Again, the title of our sermon, A Victory Song of Celebration. Victory Song of Celebration, part 3 in Judges chapter 5. So tonight, again, we have one more opportunity in our series here, our brief series, one more opportunity to celebrate with the children of Israel as Deborah and Barak complete their victory song of celebration in Judges chapter 5. Now, as we know, to set the table for us, to give us the setting, a great battle at the Wadi Kishon has been decisively won. The torrent Kishon has swept away the armies of Jabin, king of Hazor, and his general Sisera will not be waking up from the nap that he is taking on the floor of Jael's tent. Deborah and Barak now break out into a song of praise to the Lord God of Israel. God has come down with the weak to defeat and deliver them from the mighty, showing himself to be mighty to save. Our God is a delivering, saving God. Amen? And he delights to come to the aid of those in need to deliver them from the hand of the mighty. And here in Judges 5, he has delivered Israel from the harsh oppression, a severe oppression under the Canaanite pagans. And he has proven time and time and time again his covenant faithfulness to his people. He comes now to their aid and wins this decisive battle. And so the response then of God's people to this outpouring of his grace, this outpouring of his mercy to them, is to sing, right? They sing in praise of God, and they sing in praise of God for his mighty deeds. Verse 3, "Hear, O kings, give ear, O princes, I, even I, will sing to the Lord, I will sing praise to the Lord God of Israel." As we said last Lord's Day, this is no refined ballad, right? This is no sullen sonnet. This is no soft, effeminate, pretty, light a candle love song. This is a mess with us again, I dare you fight song. That's what this song is. It's a battle hymn of Israel. Now, some would say this is scandalous. Some would say this is seedy or unrefined. No, God's people do not see it this way. When you understand sin, when you understand the forces, the enemies of God at work against him, no, this is not scandalous. This is not unrefined. This is a righteous, pious, worshipful, praising song of celebration of God's victory over his enemies. That's what Judges 5 is. Now, this song of celebration, this song of victory, is divided into three sections. Each of the three sections highlighting a contrast. In section 1, of the song from verses 1 through 12. Section 1 features a contrast between the power of God and the powerlessness of Israel. God is introduced in verse 4 as mighty and marching out toward victory, the victor of his people. We see his people in the wilderness, right? And God is marching out from the wilderness, marching out from Sinai toward Seir, marching out from Seir through Edom, conquering their enemies before them and leading them into the promised land. God is their conquering hero. The earth and the heavens and the mountains tremble as God moves through the wilderness. And with Yahweh as her God, you would expect that the children of Israel would be unconquerable. They would be undefeatable. But the sin of Israel and God's righteous judgment left the nation powerless. Israel is powerless against her enemies, and now under the iron fist of a ruthless enemy in verse 6. Village life here is decimated. The highways are deserted. Israelites were driven into their homes, driven into hiding, utterly incapable of doing anything to help themselves, anything to defend themselves, or anything to better their position. Not a shield or a spear found among 40,000 in Israel. However, the children of Israel have God as their God. So the children of Israel cried out to God for mercy. And God, the faithful God who keeps covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments, our God heard their cry and answers their prayer. He hears them in their distress, he remembers them in their misery, and he provides for their deliverance. In section 2 of the song, from verses 13 through 23, this section features a contrast between those allies of the Lord that the Lord leads into battle and all those enemies that are defeated at his hand. And we saw last Lord's Day how even within the camp of supposed allies, there are still those who would prove themselves to be faithless. and those who, because of their faithlessness, would discourage the hearts of the faithful. Nevertheless, despite those, Deborah records those who took place in the victory, the faithful, those who honored the word of God, those who esteemed God, esteemed his word, esteemed his promises, and those who, for his sake, loved not their own lives, even to the point of death. Those allies are contrasted with the enemy that shows up in verse 19. Look there at verse 19 with me. The kings came and fought. Then the kings of Canaan fought in Taanach by the waters of Megiddo. We looked at that destination in our study of Judges chapter 4. And they took no spoils of silver. Now, Jabin and Sisera, as it turns out, are representatives here in verse 19 of all of the enemies of Israel, which are the Canaanites and all the kings of the Canaanites. Here, Jabin and Sisera stand for all the kings of Canaan, and all the kings of Canaan are said to have come down in verse 19 to fight in Taanach by the waters of Megiddo. And, subsequently, all the kings of Canaan were defeated. Might as well have defeated the whole lot and driven them all out of Canaan. There would be no spoils of water for them, and God is victorious over these kings. What happened? Look at verse 20 with me. What happened? They fought from the heavens. The stars from their courses fought against Sisera. In other words, God brought all the forces of nature to this battle. All the power of God was arrayed against the powerlessness of the Canaanites as he drew from heaven to defeat them. And verse 21, the torrent of Kishon swept them away. That ancient torrent, the torrent of Kishon. Now, Deborah, reveling in this, at the wonder of it all, you can imagine that victory given them by God, Deborah responds with an exclamation of exhortation to herself, the end of verse 21, "Oh, my soul, march on in strength." Now, you and I have probably said something like that to ourselves. I have certainly over my Christian life before. There have been times when I've been so wrapped up in the grace and mercy and might and power and faithfulness of God that I just have to remind myself, what am I doing? Why don't I serve him more faithfully, right? It's the same kind of a thing. We see the grace and mercy of God and we say to ourselves, oh man, I have no business doing anything else but serving him with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. God is worthy of that kind of commitment. And that's the kind of commitment that Deborah is saying to herself here in verse 21. Oh, my soul, march on in strength. Right? We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Do you believe that? More than conquerors. He always leads us in triumph in Christ. And the Lord God will give us the victory. This is an exclamation of victorious faith in verse 21. Oh, my soul, march on in strength. When you find yourself in difficulty, you find yourself in adversity, when you're facing a challenge, remember the strength, the mercy, the grace, the goodness of God toward you, that God is powerful against every enemy of ours. He is sovereign over every adversity that we face, and say to yourself, as Deborah did, oh, my soul, march on in strength. We have no reason to do anything different, right? But to march on in strength. So that's what Deborah proclaims here in verse 21. And then in verse 22, then the horse's hooves pounded, the galloping of his steeds. Now the infantry here in verse 22 is owned by Jabin. These are his horses, and we know what happens. The Wadi Kishon becomes wet, becomes doused with rain. The torrent comes. That wadi turns into a mud pit. What happens to iron chariots and horses when they're caught in the mud? Here you can imagine a horse's hooves pounding in the mud. The word galloping there, that word has the sense of rearing up. The rearing up of stallions is exactly what it's talking about. And so you have a picture here of the horses that are caught up in the torrent. They're caught up in the mud, struggling at the Wadi Kishon. And we know what happens, right? The armies of Israel rout Jabin and his 900 chariots of army and win the battle. God wins the battle for them. So then Deborah ends this section now with a final command by the Malach Yahweh, or the messenger of the Lord, in verse 23. Listen, verse 23. "Curse Meroz," said the angel of the Lord. "Curse its inhabitants bitterly." Why? Because they did not come to the help of the Lord, to the help of the Lord against the mighty. And here we have this city, Meroz. Meroz, obviously a city inhabited by Israelites. So think with me about what this says. Meroz expected, in verse 23, expected to come to the battle to aid their countrymen to fight for the Lord against the mighty, against the enemies of God. But they did not. Meroz expected to be there, but they did not come. Now, it may be the reason for the curse here that, if you remember, nor Reuben, nor Gilead, nor Dan, nor Asher got for their failure to come. Now we see in verse 23, Meroz doesn't come to the battle, and they're cursed by the angel of the Lord in verse 23. It may be that the city was very close, making their obstinance that much more offensive to God, that they didn't come to the aid of their countrymen like they should have. Whatever the reason, they incur the wrath of God here in verse 23 in a way that even Reuben, Gilead, Dan, or Asher did not. And they are cursed bitterly by the Moloch, Yahweh, or the messenger, the envoy, who is from God here. Now this, in verse 23 then, sets up another contrast for us. We've been talking about contrasts through this song. Verse 23 sets up another contrast in this second section of Deborah's song. Meroz, along with Reuben, Gilead, Dan, and Asher, are Israelites who refuse to stand with the one true and living God against his enemies. They refuse to stand with God. While section 3 of the song begins with Jael, who is a Gentile woman who will stand with the one true and living God of Israel against their enemies. You see the contrast? The people of Israel, these tribes, particularly here, Meroz, won't stand with God for all that God has done for them, and yet here's a Gentile woman, Jael, who will. Right? This is exceedingly shameful. Exceedingly shameful. Meroz, think of the blessings and the privileges that the children of Israel have had from the Lord. We talked about this or studied this in Romans chapter 9 a sermon or two ago in our study on the essentials on Sunday morning, right? Meroz, who are Israelites, to quote Paul in Romans 9, they're Israelites to whom pertain the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, and the promises, of whom are the fathers. Meroz should have known better. Amen? Should have known better. What have they done? They've taken the grace and mercy of God for granted here. Look at all they've got. They've taken it for granted. Being the recipients of such grace, being the benefactors of such blessing, and in the end, all of that has been received in vain, and it profits Meroz nothing. Meroz is cursed. Why? Why? Because Meroz sat by and did not take up the Lord's cause. That's why. Of all that Meroz had been given, all the blessings afforded to them, Meroz then sits by, does not take up the Lord's cause against the Lord's enemies, and Meroz is cursed, cursed for it. Put to shame by a Gentile woman who would have been pleased to have eaten from the crumbs that fell from the master's table. Yeah, remember that story? Jael, a Gentile woman who would have been pleased with the crumbs that fell from her master's table, while the children of Israel sit by. Did the Lord need their help? Did the Lord need the help of Meroz to win the battle? No. No. He wins the battle. He's victorious without their help. He needs no one or no thing. He certainly would have won the battle. He did win the battle, but the Lord says in Luke chapter 11, verse 23, he who is not with me is what? Is against me. Is against me. He who does not gather with me, what? He scatters abroad. He scatters abroad. We've received such grace from God, have we not? You and I are the recipients of tremendous, lavish outpourings of God's grace and mercy. If you're in Christ, it is because God, in abounding grace, from the riches of his mercy, has reached to you to cause you to be born again, to transform your wicked heart from a rebellious, perverse, corrupt heart to a heart that loves him, loves the Lord Jesus Christ, loves righteousness. The Lord has done that for you. The Lord has forgiven you of your sin. He's adopted you into his household as a son or daughter of the kingdom. We have such blessings. We have the fullness of God's revelation given to us, the fullness of God's revelation in the Lord Jesus Christ himself given to us. We've received such grace from the Lord. And the Lord says that we are not to receive the grace of God in vain. We're not to receive the grace of God in vain. Meraz, that's exactly what they did. All that grace received in vain. May we never be indifferent to it as Meraz was. We must stand with him. Stand with him in his cause, for his purposes, for his aims, for his glory. If you are a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are employed in his work. Do you see? You are now an ambassador for Christ, Paul says. You are employed in the gospel work of preaching the gospel to all creatures. You are employed, so to speak, in God gathering his elect from the four corners of the earth. You are employed in the service of his people to make disciples. You're employed in his cause. Here, Meraz says, nah, you know, we simply don't care. Don't care, not going to show up, and Meraz is cursed. Stand with him. If you're not with him in the work, preaching the gospel, making disciples, serving in the Lord's church, loving the Lord's people, then you are against him. If you're not gathering with him, then you are scattering abroad. Do you see? Meraz here is cursed. There were cities in the New Testament cursed, right? The Lord cursed Bethsaida. The Lord cursed Chorazin. Cursed because if the light that was revealed to them had been displayed, manifested in Sodom and Gomorrah, then those two wicked and perverse cities would have remained to this day, the Lord said. And yet they received the grace of God in vain. They received the grace of God in vain. We have such graces given to us, such blessings, such privileges. It's the privilege to be here tonight. Amen? A privilege to have a church building where we can gather in. A privilege to be saved to a body with other believers that we can fellowship with and share with and have sweet fellowship together, love one another, right? This is a blessing, a tremendous blessing. A church like this, where the people are, they love the Lord, they love the Lord's word, they love one another, this is a tremendous blessing. We cannot receive the grace of God in vain. We can't be like Meraz. Do you see? We can't sit by while others take up the cause of the Lord. We must pick up the mantle of ministry ourselves. Do you see? You and I, we. The church is not a nebulous thing, right? The church is not an ethereal, undefinable, nebulous blob that the Lord created. It's made up of you and me. It's made up of individuals, people that the Lord has redeemed. It's you and I. We are the church. Do you see? So it's up to you, it's up to me to pick up the mantle of ministry and serve the Lord in his cause. We're not to sit by. Here, God issues a curse against those who sat by while others fought the Lord's battles. Do you see? Let it not be said of us. This is our generation. This is our time. This is our area. This is our place. This is our location, right? This is our community. These are our neighborhoods. This is our place, our time. Let's be faithful, amen? Let's be faithful in our time. Let's be faithful in what the Lord has called us to do. Let's be faithful in his work, laboring with him, gathering with him, so it's not said of us that we are scattering or against him. So as we come then to section 3 in the Song of Deborah in verses 24 through 30, in section 3 now, we find lastly a contrast between Jael, the workman's hammer, and the mother of Sisera. It's a poignant vignette, contrast here between Jael and the mother of Sisera. Now the third section here of the song begins with Jael. From the raging battle in the Wadi Kishon among thousands here to a seemingly insignificant and private encounter between two people. One commentator remarks that the killing of Sisera is recorded here with savage pleasure. I like that. It is true. Look at verse 24. Most blessed among women is Jael. Sounds like the blessing afforded Mary at the beginning of the New Testament. Here in the Old Testament, most blessed among women is Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite. She was a Gentile woman. Blessed is she among women in tents. Here, contrasted with the women of Israel, who at this time would have lived in paneled houses. Israel is taking the land. Israel lives in houses. Here, Jael living in a tent. Blessed. Blessed is Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite. Blessed is she among women in tents. Now, the song commends her shrewdness, commends her wisdom, commends her courage. Verse 25, he, the general Sisera, asked for water. Jael was shrewd. She gave him milk. She had a plan. She was carrying out her plan. She was courageous. She had intentions here. And for as far as Sisera was concerned, they're not good intentions. She brought out cream in a lordly bowl. In other words, she gave Sisera the royal treatment. Not just water, but milk, a lavish gesture fit for a general of Jabin's army. The word for brought here, she brought out cream in a lordly bowl, is formal. Formal word. It carries the sense of presentation. She presented to Sisera a adarim, a magnificent bowl. She presented to him a lordly bowl, a magnificent or majestic bowl of cream. Now, Jael has determined her course of action. She's calculated what she is able to do to serve the God of Israel. Now, think about this with me. That's her mind. She has thought to herself, this is how I am going to serve the one true and living God of Israel. Sisera comes, passes by her tent. She sees him and calls out to him to lure him into the tent. Jael has intentions, and her intentions is to take up the cause of the king, the one true and living God of Israel. She, a Gentile woman, is going to serve the Lord. It's not unlike Rahab, you remember? Not unlike other Gentiles who have taken up the cause of the one true and living God of Israel. Here it's Jael's turn. She has intentions. She's determined her course of action. She's calculated what she can do, and now she acts in great faith. Great faith, great courage, great wisdom, great shrewdness. And then recorded with great relish, the death of the enemy of God's people at Jael's hand. Verse 26. Again in faith, right? She stretched her hand to the tent peg, her right hand to the workman's hammer. And she pounded Sisera. She pierced his head. She split and struck through his temple. Now remember when we looked at this in Judges 4, Jael would have been really handy with a tent peg and a hammer. It was up to the women at that day and time to put up the tents. She would have known exactly what to do. She would have been very proficient with the hammer. And what is recorded there is a blast from Jael. Likely one strike was all it took. One hammer to the peg, and the peg drives through Sisera's head into the floor of the tent and kills Sisera, splits his head right there at her feet. She pierced his head, she split and struck through his temple. At her feet he sank, he fell, he lay still. At her feet he sank, he fell. It might have been, could have been, we're speculating, that the first blow was a shock to Sisera. Maybe he had enough strength, I can't imagine, right? But to maybe get to his knees or to attempt a move. But he sank, he fell, he lay still. Where he sank, there he fell dead. Jael, in Judges chapter 5, portrayed as anything but a foolish woman. Jael is portrayed as a strong, courageous, shrewd, wise, triumphant woman. She is the workman's hammer. Do you see? That's where we get the title of our sermon, the workman's hammer. This is Jael. While the men of Meroz, that shameful lot, while the men of Meroz loiter behind in their paneled houses, Jael calls out to Sisera from her tent. to lure her enemy to her. What do we see in contrast to this faithful, bold, and decisive act of Jael? In contrast, Meroz, despite all its privileges, is cursed. The weak men of Israel are shamed. God's enemies are humiliated. Baal is seen as utterly worthless. Their general is dead at the hand of a woman. And Jael, God's appointed means of deliverance, is memorialized in song. Why? Because of her shrewdness, because of her faith, because of her courage, because she took up the hammer against God's enemies. Do you see? She did what she could. The Puritan, Richard Rogers, commenting on this text, said this. He said, many silly persons, now think of that word silly for me, in the 16th century when Rogers was writing, the word silly in the English of the day meant innocent or meant deserving of compassion. Silly meant someone who is simple, right? So think of it that way, not terms of silly as in foolish. So many simple people, many innocent people, those that you might see as deserving of or needful of compassion, many of those persons so furnished with the grace of God have forced great ones to wish from their hearts for all their wealth and power that they were like unto them. You see what's being said about Jael? In other words, it's that one who, despite what the world would see as their desperate condition or needful condition or their humble estate or their difficult plight or their difficult state, those who simply in faith serve the Lord faithfully in what they've been called to do, in their circumstance, in their time, in their place, they take up the Lord's cause, and in humble, simple, devoted faith, they faithfully serve God. It will be those who are great, those who are powerful, those who are mighty, those who believe themselves to be proud, those who believe themselves to be worth something, it will be them, for all their wealth and power, that they wish they were like Jael. Do you see? We get so caught up in wanting more for ourselves that we forget it's just simple faithfulness. Simple obedience, right? Following the Lord. Obeying the Lord. Living for Him. Simple acts of love and devotion. It's like Mary in John chapter 11. An innocent person, someone you might think would be in need of compassion, who on the night before Jesus Christ was crucified, she broke the alabaster flask of costly, costly oil. She anointed the head, anointed the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. Loved in that way, devoted to the Lord in that way, giving her prized possession for Him, for His cause, for His sake. And what does the Lord do? He memorializes her. Wherever the gospel's preached in all the world, what this woman has done will be remembered. It's the simple things, right? It's not that complicated. Doesn't take the mighty, doesn't take the wealthy, doesn't take the powerful. It just takes the faithful, the faith-filled. It takes those who are devoted of heart and mind to the Lord Jesus Christ. And that here is Jael, someone who we might think was simple, living in a tent. And yet here, Jael, apart from God, who is the hero of our song, Jael here is lifted in Judges 5 as a heroine. And what of Sisera? What of Sisera, that proud enemy of God? What of the haughty, right? What of the mighty one, the general Sisera? The Lord brings to naught the high and haughty. He brings forth the mighty from their God-defying seat of supposed power. What does God do? He puts them to an open shame. Puts them to an open shame. Listen, God knows how to cast down the proud. It's not just that God casts down the proud and gives grace to the humble. He certainly does that, but God knows how to do it. Think with me for a moment about Sisera. An illustration of this would be Abimelech. Abimelech in Judges chapter 9. God draws out Abimelech on his high horse, so to speak, and then an unnamed woman drops a millstone on his head. And he calls to his armor bearer, his page, his little servant boy, and he says, "Draw your sword and kill me, so it's not said of me that I was killed at the hand of a woman." God knows how to cast down the proud. Do you see? What about Jezebel, that vile, despicable, disgusting woman in 2 Kings chapter 9? God spoke by Elijah about what he would do to her. Jehu shows up at her house. She puts on her makeup. She calls out from an upstairs window, "Is it peace? Is it peace?" That wicked woman. Jehu calls back to others in the room. He says, "Who's on my side?" In other words, who's on the Lord's side? Who's on the Lord's side? "Throw her down," he calls. There were a couple of eunuchs up there who took Jezebel by the scruff of the neck and threw her out of the window. Her blood splattered on the wall of the building, splattered on his horse. He trampled her with his horse. What did Jehu do? Jehu went inside to have lunch. God knows how to cast down the proud, does he not? While Jehu was inside eating his lunch, the dogs were outside eating their lunch. Nothing was left of Jezebel but her skull, her feet, and the palms of her hands, and the feces left behind by the dogs. That was all that was left of Jezebel. The Lord knows how to cast down the proud. A righteous end to Jezebel, a righteous end to Abimelech, and a righteous end to Sisera. This is the end of all those who stand opposed to God. And listen, all of that is a mere foretaste of hell. A mere foretaste of hell. God knows how to cast down the proud. God also knows how to give grace to the humble. Praise the Lord. Humble yourself before God. Acknowledge your sin against Him. Turn from your rebellion against Him. Turn to Jesus Christ in wholehearted faith and commitment, and He will give you grace. He will give you mercy. Now, contrasted with Jael is the mother of Sisera. While Jael yet clutches the hammer, look at verse 28. The mother of Sisera looked through the window, cried out through the lattice, "Why is his chariot so long in coming? Why tarries the clatter of his chariots?" That's certainly a natural response, isn't it, of a mother for her son? Concerned for his safety, the longer he's gone, the more worried, the more anxious she becomes. But be sure here in verse 28, this is a godless pity, a godless, selfish concern. She may have concern for her son, but listen, it's a concern that is in defiance of God. The Lord's cause, the Lord's people, the ever-living soul of her own son, she's concerned not for those things. She is defiant against the Lord God of Israel. It is a worldly, misplaced, fleeting, and idolatrous affection. And it's seen in how she comforts herself. Look at verse 29. It's seen in how she comforts herself. Her wisest ladies answered her, yes, she answered herself. Listen, are they not finding and dividing the spoil? Certainly that's why he's late in coming back. They're dividing the spoil amongst themselves, and she's celebrating, she's relishing the thought of this in her head. And what is the spoil they're dividing? To every man, a girl or two. The word there means a womb. Literally, in verse 30, a womb, a couple of wombs for every man. In other words, she comforts herself in the thought of her son Sisera raping and pillaging. That's what she comforts herself with. That's what she's doing in verses 29 and 30. right? Garments, plunder of dyed garments, plunder of garments embroidered and dyed, 2 pieces of dyed embroidery for the neck of the looter, and for every man a girl or two. He's raping and pillaging. She's comforting herself that he's off with the boys, getting himself into all kinds of trouble, and he's just delayed in his coming. What a godless woman, right? In her misplaced sympathy for her son. To Deborah and Barak singing this song, there's a certain sense of justice. Can't you hear it? See it there in the white space between the words? There's a certain sense of justice in the notion that she sits at home waiting and weeping for a son who will never come back, right? Vain hope, a prideful and delusional woman. God casts down the proud and gives grace to the humble. This is not unlike the wicked Haman. The wicked Haman builds the gallows, believes that he's got Mordecai dead to rights. Right? I'm going to hang Mordecai on these gallows that I've built. And then he is hung himself on the very gallows that he has made. Listen, if you are on the wrong side, you may have experienced what you believe to be a victory here or there, as certainly the mother of Sisera believed. But it will not end well for you. It will not end well. Vain hope will certainly end in everlasting shame. Vain, empty, pointless, meaningless, unbiblical hope will certainly end in everlasting shame. And you should be warning your sons and daughters with the same message, warning them, unlike the mother of Sisera, judge yourselves lest you be judged by God with the world. Well, this song, Victory Song of Celebration, comes to a conclusion in verse 31. Thus, let all your enemies perish, O Lord. Thus, let all your enemies perish, O Lord. Let all those that despise you, O God, thus perish. Let all those who take up a cause against you, our righteous, holy, victorious, gracious, loving, forgiving, merciful, kind, compassionate, holy God, let all those who take up their cause against you, God, perish in just the same way. Why? Because God is worthy of praise and devotion, worthy that we should take up his cause in praise and worship him. Let all your enemies perish like that, O Lord. Notice they're not her enemies, but God's enemies in verse 31. All those who oppose God. May all your enemies perish like Sisera. May all your enemies perish like Abimelech, like Jezebel, just like the Canaanites, just like those heartless, faithless inhabitants of Meroz. Unless they repent, they will likewise perish. Do you see? Unless you repent, you will likewise perish. What about those who stayed behind, resolved not to obey the word of God? Unless they repent, they will likewise perish. This, in verse 31, is Deborah praying, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's what she's praying here in verse 31. Thus let all your enemies perish, O Lord. But God knows how to cast down the proud, but he knows how to give grace to the humble. But, she finishes, let those who love him be like the sun when it comes out in full strength. The word for love here, verse 31, is the word ahav. It's far more than mere emotion. The word carries the sense of covenant commitment, a commitment to the Lord. The Bible says that God shows hesed, loving kindness. His covenant love for his people is a hesed love. It's a loving kindness, and it's for those who ahav, those who love him and show that love through a commitment to keep his commandments. It's love him and keep his commandments. Those who love him in this way, those who will be like the sun when it comes out in full strength, in other words, those who will be glorified, are those who love him and express that love through faithful, grateful, joyful obedience. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 18. The path of the just is like the shining sun that shines ever brighter unto the perfect day. The way of the wicked is like darkness. They do not know what makes them stumble. And so the record of the workman's hammer comes to an end in verse 31. And so the land had rest for 40 years. The overwhelming defeat of Jabin, Sisera, and the Canaanites is evidence that his ultimate victory is imminent. God wins this victory, pointing forward to the fact that he will win all of his victories. And there is an ultimate and final victory coming. Those who love him through faith in Jesus Christ will have their rest with him, not for 40 years, but into eternity. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we love you. Our desire is to be faithful to you. Our desire is, Lord, not to receive the grace of God in vain, but to place ourselves humbly under the word of God, under your revealed will, to obey you, to love you, to serve you in faith, Lord, and to be faithful with all that you've given us. With all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, to love you, to worship you, to praise you, to serve you into eternity. We praise you and thank you, Lord, that that is not in our own strength, but we have your Spirit to strengthen us, your Spirit to guide us and direct us. And we need you, Lord, in this. Help us. Help us, Lord. Protect us from being like Meraz. Protect us from being vain and shallow in our commitment like Reuben or Gilead or Dan or Asher in this particular situation, Lord. Help us. Protect us from, certainly, from being like those proud, those opposers of God, like Abimelech or like Jezebel or Haman. Lord, and help us to serve you in faith and obedience and love and devotion. Thank you, Lord, for your word. It instructs us. Give us faith, Lord, now to follow you in it. In Jesus' name, amen.